When Apple announced the return of the iPhone SE in 2020, I was pretty stoked, honestly. Finally, an affordable Apple product that didn't boast any gimmicks or notches. It was a no-nonsense utilitarian model that I could actually get behind. And for those who don't know, I find myself switching between Android and iOS quite frequently. And I also don't often buy a phone when it first launches because things tend to depreciate pretty hard in the first year, and cell phones in general are just like really freaking expensive nowadays. But I made an exception for the iPhone SE because of its price. So, how has it been holding up? Stay with me. To get rid of that annoying activation watermark, hop on over to VIP SCD Key and purchase a Windows 10 Pro OEM key for fractions of the price of retail. Just use a secure payment method like PayPal, receive your key in seconds, and activate your OS here. Bye-bye, watermark. And be sure to use our new offer code SKGS for a sweet discount. The iPhone SE is one of those phones you gotta really learn to love because, well, it's dated. The notches at the top and bottom, these aren't even really notches, they're more like chins, are pretty enormous, sharing an identical footprint with the iPhone 8 before it. Face ID has been reverted back to the old school home button with built-in fingerprint reader. I'm enjoying this. It's not bad. Everything feels a bit more analog, for lack of a better word, and that's what drew me toward it. That, and of course, the $399 price tag. At the time, it seemed like a highly compelling entry-level Apple smartphone with a hidden gem, the A13 Bionic from the iPhone 11 Pro. This thing is freaking fast for a $400 phone, and because the 4-core IGP is only driving a resolution slightly higher than 720p, which makes for a lackluster PPI, games are fluid and smooth. But let's talk about this screen. Now, it obviously is a huge step back in many regards. It's, first off, IPS rather than OLED driven. It is quite small at only 4.7 diagonal inches, and it sucks when in the sunlight. Screen brightness isn't normally an issue, but the only way to make this thing fully usable outdoors is to blast the brightness level up to 100%. But there's another problem that this ties into: battery life. So the iPhone SE 2020 is obviously, it's quite small, right? And that results in a fairly lackluster 1,821 milliamp hour cell. It's not big. And while I'm averaging mediocre screen on time, it's not terrible, but it's not okay. It's like, I just would say poor. Standby time is where this thing really sucks. Now, even with the screen off, apps like Spotify will chew through battery like there's no tomorrow. A sharp contrast to my wife's iPhone 12 mini, which boasts similar dimensions, mind you, but a 20% larger battery and more efficient processor. And while, sure, you could argue that you're paying for those added benefits in a slightly newer phone, this caliber battery is almost a deal breaker in and of itself for anyone who would consider him or herself a power user. I consider myself a power user. I'm checking my email, checking social media, all that, a lot. Trust me, it drives my wife insane. And my battery does not last a full day, not even close. Next, let's talk RAM. And I feel like this one is often misconstrued over fundamental misunderstandings of both Android and iOS. See, the latter is extremely lightweight by comparison, and memory consumption can be mitigated with fine tweaks of software that are only manageable when the same company in question, ergo Apple, optimizes both the hardware and the operating system. The result is something you'd expect from an Android phone with double the RAM, more or less. It might be a bit of an exaggeration in some cases, but you see where I'm coming from, and it's not something that should deter you from the iPhone SE if you're in the market. A similar example, though this is not apples to apples, would be in Google's case, and you have something like the Pixel 4, Pixel 4a, or the Pixel 5. Google both makes the phone and the operating system. Granted, they're using a more or less kind of generic ARM processor. It's not, you know, Google specific, Google proprietary processor, but that's about as close as I think we could get in terms of comparing Apple to Android phones. Now, in the camera department is where the SE really starts to fall short, unfortunately. It's compounded by the fact that a similar smartphone in a competing price range has one of the best still photo cameras on the market, that being, again, the Google Pixel 4a. The SE's photos aren't anywhere near as sharp or vibrant as the iPhone 12 minis, not that that's really a surprise, being that this phone is twice as expensive as the SE, but the phone struggles in any night setting, and portrait mode driven by the A13 is, It's okay. It's certainly no iPhone 12. Videos do fare quite a bit better, mind you, but I'm still not impressed for $400. This sensor is essentially pulled straight out of an iPhone 8, from what it seems like, and it really shows in these still photos. Likewise, the front camera is a bit dull for my taste and lacks the punch of comparable Google phones with software wizardry to make up for limitations in hardware. Video, it's not so bad, but what can you expect from a small sensor front-facing camera? I often find myself adding a bit of sharpness and tweaking saturation in post, which adds time and hassle to the process of posting something to social media. I also have really annoying neighbors with straight piped inline four cars and they sound like garbage. The next one's more or less an observation at this point, considering so many phones have followed this unfortunate trend, IMO, lack of a headphone jack. You don't get a headphone jack in the iPhone SE. If you're looking forward to that headphone jack, this is not the phone for you. You could use an adapter. There's a bit of a quality loss associated with the lightning cable to 3.5mm adapter, but it is a solution nonetheless, kind of a workaround. But if you have that and you don't have a special third-party adapter, you can't charge your phone and listen to music via wired, headphones at the same time, unless you are, for some reason, wirelessly charging and then you have the adapter plugged in. That would be kind of weird, but you could do it, I guess. That said, there are a few positive attributes to counter what most, I assume, would call negatives. For one, the stereo speaker setup in the SE is quite nice. Apple has traditionally done a pretty good job with built-in phone speakers, and the SE is no exception. Surprisingly decent punch and dynamic range from the lower unit, while the earpiece remains a bit more tinny, still managing to fill out that stereo effect. I'll let you have a listen here. Another nice inclusion is wireless charging. It's one of those things that many of us take for granted at this point in higher end phones, but it is fairly easy to implement when plastic and glass are used at the rear. So I guess I'm not really surprised that it is here because this is an all glass back. But it is Apple we're talking about, right? We're talking about Apple here, and they've been known to cut plenty of corners and in effect to maximize profit, maximize yields. The SE's solid glass backing does again make this possible. It looks pretty great at the same time, although it is a fingerprint magnet. By the way, while we're on the subject of looks, this thing's a beauty, if I've ever seen one. Yes, the chins are a bit annoying, but I've always loved the look of the iPhone 7 and 8, and I honestly wasn't disappointed to see them reuse this frame for the SE refresh. It has great proportions all around and easily fits in the hand. So my conclusion is this: the Apple iPhone SE is okay for the price. I mean, it still leaves me wanting a bit more considering its MSRP, but I suppose that was Apple's goal all along. I mean, to get you to spend a bit more next time. I don't regret the time I've spent with this phone, and I can certainly appreciate its relatively small price. It's $400. That used to be pretty high end, and now it's definitely not. But this has not been my favorite phone by any stretch of the imagination, and it doesn't tick all of the boxes I think a $400 phone should. That said, again, this is Apple we're talking about, and the Apple ecosystem is incredibly versatile in-network, but incredibly stubborn when it comes to shaking hands with anything missing the Fruit logo. So, if you truly feel the urge to go Apple for your next budget phone, at least you have something in the SE. But be warned, you'll be wanting quite a bit more within only a few months. By that time, the battery life issue will be creeping up on you, the cameras will become outright frustrating to work with, and those fat chins will drive you mad. Or maybe they won't. So if, after watching this video, you're able to manage expectations and stretch that $399 ask, the iPhone SE could make a great budget partner for your MacBook, iPad, or Apple Watch. For things like AirDrop and iMessage, which some would honestly consider essential services, you've no choice really but to go Apple. But it's nice to have a relatively affordable option from them, and that's why I'm ultimately glad that the new SE exists, regardless of my personal feelings about it going into 2021. For more of my thoughts on Apple and other Apple reviews, check out the cards up top. They'll be somewhere up here, I think, or check them out via the links below. Be sure to give this one a thumbs up if you enjoyed it and consider subscribing if you haven't already. My name is Greg. Thanks for learning with me.